Yes.
The President of the United States, Mrs. Douglas MacArthur, and the Secretary of Defense.
Please be seated.
Here, and it's a delight to have such a perfect day for this very happy ceremony. And we're particularly delighted that everyone could be here, particularly honored that our President, our Commander-in-Chief, is able to be with us. Your presence, sir, symbolizes both the admiration and the great honor that we pay to the memory of General MacArthur today, and that's why we're particularly grateful to you for joining us in this tribute to a very dauntless patriot and an extraordinary soldier. The dedication of public places is not only a way of remembering and praising those who have distinguished themselves, those who have led the way in the past, but it's also a way of inspiring those who will lead us in the future. So I expect that the MacArthur Corridor that we will dedicate very shortly inside this great building will guide and inspire future generations of military leaders as they walk through the hall. We will shortly dedicate this hall, we will shortly dedicate the corridor to the memory of General MacArthur, and thus he will continue to live here in the building that enshrines the activities in which he was engaged all of his adult life. And his memory will set an example, as did his actions in his life, for those who guard our shores and protect our liberties. It's a great pleasure now to have the opportunity to introduce a lady whom I first met in Brisbane, Australia in 1943. Then, as now, she worked indefatigably for the good of the military and the country. I had the great privilege of serving under General MacArthur in a very minor capacity as one of the platoon leaders, one of the two divisions assigned to his command at that time, and then later in his intelligence staff. And at all times, all of us heard a great deal about MacArthur and the enormously valuable work that she performed for the man she always called her general. She was dedicating, at the time I first met her, a new great novelty of the Southwest Pacific, a USO, which was one of the first in the theater. I don't believe that she remembers me from that time. I was a face in the crowd, but I remember her very well, and I can't think of any better way to introduce her than to point out that her energy and her spirit and her grace entitled her to full recognition in her own right. But I think that probably she would rather be introduced in the way that I am about to do so. Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Douglas MacArthur.
Mr. President, Mr. Secretary, Mr. Wagner, really it's difficult for me to find words to express all of this today. Really, I feel I could just never thank you.
We are, as I said, particularly honored today to have our commander in chief with us. It is the second visit to the Pentagon in a short time, and that pleases me very much. It symbolizes and signifies the enormous respect and admiration for all the men and women in the uniform, for our services, and for all of those who work for the military all over the world. And that what I'm going to just say is that it's an enormous honor to be on the stage today, ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States.
Here, ladies and gentlemen,
cold west, where there's been a sudden war here when I first heard the sound of guns and shouted guns. You could hear those sounds in Wilson when he was graduated from West Point, one of the most academic and Virginia history, and from the enemy's greatest enemy. First captain of the Corps, Douglas MacArthur. As a young officer, on a secret path dangerous in his mission in Mexico, he flew in his first recommendation for Congressional Medal of Honor. Wounded twice in France during World War I, he would be decorated repeatedly for his book on Identifier and become one of the most popular generals in American history. As the superintendent of the military academy, he would bring up the reformer to the West Point curriculum, upgrade scholastic standards, while emphasizing the importance of sports. Words he spoke then were even now inscribed at West Point in stone. Upon the fields of friendly strife are the seeds that upon other fields on other days will bear the fruit of victory. In the early 30s, as the youngest Army Chief of Staff in history, he warned the troops of the need for military readiness and modern army featuring strong armored air forces. Of bearing the brunt of the Japanese attack in 1942, he would win the Congressional Medal of Honor for his heroic defense of the Philippines. And when ordered by President Roosevelt to leave the islands, he would thrill the free world with his defiant pledge, "I shall return." During his brilliant military campaign in the South Pacific, his island hopping hit him where they ain't. Strategy won quick victories with limited resources. Victories that saved thousands of American lives, electrified his countrymen, and confounded the enemy. The post-war ruler of Japan, he showed himself a wise and compassionate statesman who won forever the affection of the Japanese people, even as he brought about one of the most remarkable achievements in the history of self-government. Then in Korea, in the face of brutal aggression, he accomplished one of the most brilliant maneuvers in military history, the Incheon Landing. And in 1951, before a joint session of the Congress, he would give one of the most memorable speeches in American history, a speech in which he warned, and we must always remember, in war, indeed, there can be no substitute. It is true that his brilliant career sometimes aroused envy of lesser men. The general sought to lead intrigue to headquarters staff and politicians. He was always a frontline general, a leader of fighting men. Once in a remote airfield in Guinea, an officer spotted him near the front lines and rushed up to him. In a worried voice, he pointed to a spot of jungle 50 yards away and said, "Excuse me, sir, but we killed a sniper in there only a few minutes ago." General answered, "Fine, son, that's the best thing to do with them." Even at the age of 82, he was giving the same inspiring example to young soldiers. The class of 1962 at West Point will never forget the words they heard from him one May afternoon, words that he began with a bit of humor. He said, "As I was leaving the hotel this morning, the doorman asked me, 'Where are you headed for, General?' When I replied, 'West Point,' he remarked, 'Beautiful place. Never been there before.'" But then came that unforgettable speech, a speech in which he reminded those young soldiers that duty, honor, country were three hallowed words that reverently dictate what you ought to be, what you can be, and what you will be. They are your rallying points, he said, to build courage when courage seems to fail, to rebuild faith when there seems to be so little purpose for faith, to create hope when hope becomes forlorn. He spoke of his pride on the gray line that has never failed us. He told the cadets that his last waking thoughts would be of the Corps, and the Corps, and the Corps. He was extraordinarily proud of his country's uniform. He said of it once, "I suppose in a way, this has become a part
symbol of life. Whatever I've done that really matters, I've done wearing. When the time comes, it will be indeed the morning journey forth. What greater honor would come to an American and a soldier? But today, a new generation of young officers are asked to defend our nation, just as a new generation of young Americans to whom World War II, Korea, and even Vietnam, not even within memory, seek to define their own ideas and search for their own answers to ageless questions. Surely as the time recedes from this era, this new generation will see Douglas MacArthur, an unflinching idealist, an eloquent warrior, a visionary soldier, a gentle conqueror, an authentic grows old by merely living a number of years. People grow old by deserting their ideals. As long as America affords her brave a place of honor, as long as we as a people seek to keep alive the ideals of selflessness and freedom, as long as we look to the wise and the just for inspiration, our thoughts will turn to the general and the general.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. That concludes the ceremony, and we will now dedicate the card to General MacArthur and the purpose for which we have come today.